How you doing?
I'm good. How you doing, Char?
I am good. You know, I'm not going to complain. I'm not going to listen anyway.
Yeah, who's going to give a damn?
Right.
Yeah.
So this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to introduce the show again so we have a fresh start. I'm going to introduce you, and then we're going to chop it up.
Let's do that.
Okay. I am Charmel McMillan. This is my 111th episode of my show, Just One Thing, my show about life-changing moments, life-defining moments, things that push us closer to our purpose, closer to our destiny, the journey, the thing, the path that's been laid for us, where we fit into the grand scheme of things. My show is based on my best-selling book, Just One Thing, Foreword by my longtime friend, 27 years, Mike Epps. And so it is the testament of my life-changing moments. You know, those things that, you know, sometimes you feel like you're not going to get through, but somehow, but God, so that's what my book is about. So on Thursday, Friday, Saturday nights, and sometimes Mondays, we are talking about life-changing moments of other people. So with that being said, my guest tonight is the one and only Jake Staley, comedian. I'm going to claim it into existence, producer, movie director, selling out box offices all over the world. That's what he's doing. That's what he's doing. That's what he's doing. So we already speaking it. How you doing, love?
That's it. I'm good. I'm feeling great.
I feel great too.
Oh my God. Tonight it just feel, you know, you feel a little loose. I feel loose. I might try some shit tonight. I don't know. I might try some loose shit. I don't know. I'm gonna tell you something. Tonight, your cheeks gonna hurt. I feel like that. Okay.
Well, that's why I went to grab. I went to grab my paper towel because, you know, sometimes y'all get me unexpectedly. I can't remember who was on the other night, but they had me crying real tears, and I didn't expect that from them. I can't remember who it was, but oh my God, I've had so many guests. And then, you know, Ali, I went on live with him yesterday, the day before. I was tears rolling in the morning. I don't even know what happened.
I was live with that fool this morning.
I saw. Well, somebody tagged me, but I didn't get to see the clip. But yeah.
Yeah. I was live with that fool this morning. No, wow. We was talking about his special. But, hey, tonight I'm on CHAR-TOWN Entertainment.
Okay, so let's get it popping. I talk about the journey. So I start with the formative years in my conversation. I don't even call them interviews. In my conversation, I start with the formative years. I want to know where you were born. Where did you grow up? I want to know what your family structure was like. Was it mother, father, brothers, sisters? And I want to know what little Jake was like.
Ooh.
Yeah, I do.
Little Jake. All right. Okay, so I was born here in Columbia, South Carolina. Mm-hmm. I grew up in a little town called Kinsler, South Carolina. Now, Kinsler is only three streets.
Okay.
Three. Yeah, Kinsler, St. James Avenue. I ain't never been on another road. Okay. Now, I don't know the name of it.
Now, you don't know the name of Third Street?
No, I don't know the name of that street. But... As a kid growing up, I didn't grow up in the best situation, okay? I mean, I always had mama. I always had the women in my family. I always had them. Mama, aunts, sisters, you know, female cousins, things of that nature. I didn't have a male figure. I had uncles, but they had their own life. You know, they didn't have time to be uncles. They, you know, they were daddies too. Mm-hmm. So, I grew up in a poverty-ish type of way, you know. Didn't have much. Mm-hmm. You know, mama struggled and did what she could. Mama stood in the fire. She did what she could do for her children.
Right.
And like as a child, what would you call me?
Bad as hell.
I was bad. So I was bad, but I always had a motive.
Mm-hmm. For being bad.
It was for being bad. I always had a reason for letting the air out your tire.
You let the air out your tires? Okay.
But see, the thing is, I didn't cut your tire.
Okay. You show grace and mercy. You show grace.
I showed grace. I was mad with you. So I just took a nail and pressed a button in the air thing.
Okay.
And let your air detect. I was that kid.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But, like I said, I grew up in Counselor. It was just my mama. I mean, my granddad was there. My aunt was there. Her kids. My mama, her kids. Mm-hmm. You know, it was rough, Shaw.
Wow.
But.
So you said it was your mama and who else with their kids?
My aunt and her kids.
Oh, okay. So all y'all live together. Oh.
My aunt and her kids. My uncle. Cousins that was older. They lived there. My grandfather was there. It was a bunch of us in this motherfucker.
Wow. It's a little house, though.
It wasn't that little.
Okay.
But it wasn't that big, neither. You know what I'm saying? We all fit. But it was, the only thing is, it was only one heater. And when you got that many people in the house with one heater, you got to be first in line to get to that goddamn heat. Because there's one heater in this room, the rest of the house cold in the motherfucker. Yeah. So, if you don't, everybody went to sleep. Mm-hmm. This is true. When it's time to go lay down and go to sleep, it's 11 blankets in the house. It's 15 people. Wow. If you don't get to a blanket, you better get to the heater first.
That's a lot.
Because if you go on the street, motherfucker, you had to, I'm telling you, I'll never get a blanket. Uh-huh. It seemed like if I got one, by the time I woke up the next morning, my shit was gone. So they motherfuckers took the cover. Huh?
They took your stuff. Your blanket.
Listen, you can wrap up tight as you want. When you wake up in the morning, you look over, and your cousin over there got your blanket wrapped up in it. Because they were late. But I didn't grow up, we didn't have a lot, but we had, I learned a lot from my childhood.
Mm-hmm.
I learned what not to do in my childhood.
Right.
Okay. So, like I said, I grew up in a little small community. It's not even a town. It's a community called Counselor, South Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Half of my life.
Okay.
The other half of my life, I grew up in Swansea, South Carolina. That's where my dad is.
Okay.
Now, that's more country.
That's more country than the three street city? Okay.
I went way down the country with my dad.
Okay.
Living with your daddy. That's why I say I look at Ali Sadiq's special today. It was so crazy. The things he was saying. His dad was a drug dealer. My daddy was a nigga who did the drug. Now, if we're gonna talk real, if we're gonna tell my story, I'm gonna tell my story. I'm not gonna lie. I'm not gonna sugarcoat this shit.
Okay.
So I didn't know how fun it was to have a parent on drugs until I experienced this.
Okay.
So, I'm telling you, my dad, I'm in Columbia. Hey, in Columbia. My dad, I invited some people over, so they should be coming.
Okay.
So, my dad is from Swansea, South Carolina.
Uh-huh.
My dad was a millionaire when I was young. My daddy was a millionaire.
Like the real millionaire?
My daddy. You're a real millionaire. My daddy owned a construction company.
Okay.
And he was the number one contractor in the Southeast, not South Carolina, in the Southeast. My dad built, he was a builder, and he built shit all the way from Florida all the way up to D.C. He was building.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Mm-hmm. He was a millionaire. This was before, this was right before, you know, this is the cocaine era.
Okay.
So my grandmother is from Florida. His mom is from Fort Lauderdale, Florida.
Mm-hmm.
And in Florida is where they get a lot of the drugs from. They get a lot of drugs from Florida. Mm-hmm. So my dad started investing his money in cocaine. So he would go down there and get lots of cocaine and bring it back here.
I know you were young and you were a little boy, but do you have any idea how that happens? Like, how do you get the plug to even do that. Like, if somebody said, hurry up, Char, get some cocaine. I've been in this industry 26 years. I wouldn't know where to start. Like, how do you do that?
Look, I didn't really witness. A lot of people told me stories. Uh-huh. I didn't really witness this with my eyes.
Okay.
But my brother is older. He's 10 years older, so he witnessed this.
Okay, got you.
And he's bringing it back here. And he ended up getting on drugs.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Ended up losing everything.
My God.
So I never got the opportunity to be a rich kid. Because by the time it was time for me to be a rich kid, all the goddamn money was gone.
Okay. You missed that window.
I'm still mad about that shit. But
life-changing moment number one. Okay.
Gotcha. Yeah. So my whole life as a young man
mm-hmm.
has been a comedy show.
Yeah.
My dad never whipped my ass, but my mama did.
Mm.
I remember a time in school. I remember a time I got into this guy.
Mm-hmm.
His name is Sean. I never forget. His name is Sean. And Sean and I were friends.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, in school, you got this side over here and that side over there. Boosting shit up. So right. They know me and Sean friend, but they wanted me and Sean to fight. They didn't know, because I used to act like I was a bad motherfucker, mm-hmm. but they didn't know that I couldn't fight. They thought I was a dude that could bam in school.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't know I couldn't fight. So at school, I done boost up. I'm jumping up and down like I'm getting ready for a heavyweight motherfucking bout.
Mm-hmm.
I said, oh, I'm going to tear his ass up. So by the time we got to the field, mm-hmm. Sean pulled out a knife. Sean pulled a knife out of his pocket. I was like, oh, shit. Now, I done did the windmill, but mm-hmm. I ain't never went against no goddamn knife. You know what I'm saying?
All you so had was the windmill?
That's all I had, the windmill.
Okay.
I grew up around a bunch of women. I was taught that. See, but,
you was done. After you did that, you was done.
I closed my eyes.
Did you?
And I'm trying to fight you. If I don't fight you, the fight got damn over. So,
you silly as hell.
I'm serious. When I close them up, I close them first and I pray.
You praying what? While you doing the windmill.
I don't know where this nigga at. I'm just playing. But
you're not gonna mess up my little bit of eyeliner, Jake.
But Sean, me and Sean, we met. Sean pulled his knife out, and I was like, "Shit, I can't fight against no knife." So my sister was like, "Come on, this motherfucker cut your ass up. Come on, let's go." So me and my sister, we uh-huh. all ass. I could walk to school almost.
Okay.
It was a little bit too far, but it was close enough
mm-hmm.
to where I can walk home. So I walk home, and I'm thinking, you know what I'm saying? My sister going to, like, not going to say shit, but my mm-hmm. sister, Tara Staley. That's my sister.
Okay.
She was a fucking snitch. Soon, I thought we were good to go. We didn't talk. Me and my sister was friends from the walk from the school all the way home. We were friends. Soon we got in the house. Ma, somebody put a knife on Jake and kill him at the school. He was at the by the fight. In my mind, I'm saying you dirty bitch. So, my mama told me, go out there and get a switch.
Mm-hmm.
I'm 14 years old.
Oh, wow.
Go out there and get a switch.
You were 14 doing the windmill and now? You was 14 doing the windmill?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, I was 14 doing the women. I'm trying to find something. I went and got a switch mm-hmm. on a Dushin goddamn bead. It had one leaf on the front. And I handed it to my mama. She slapped the shit out. And she slapped me. She told my brother, go out there and give me a switch. My brother went in there and got a fucking branch. He went outside and got a branch. Off
a portion of a tree.
So I'm standing there, when my brother walked in the house with that motherfucker, I said, oh no. I took off running.
Uh-huh.
When I took off running, the switch was so long, when she went out and hit me with it, uh-huh. It hit me across the back. But when it hit me across the back, I was still running. I was like, okay, I can get away. But it was another part of the switch on the top of it that came round and slapped me in the fucking chest. Pow! That's where the pow noise came from.
That's where it came from? Your mama created that.
I was trying to figure out where the noise came from. But the back of the switch hit me in the back, and then the rest of the switch came around and hit me in the chest. Pow!
My God.
I looked back at her, and she was standing there. I said, oh, my goodness. Listen, I didn't grow up in the house where mama put you in the corner. I don't know what the fucking corner looked like. I got my ass cut. I was a bad child. I got kicked out of high school every year.
Every year?
Went to alternative school. Every year. Wow. I had to go to alternative school because I was a clown.
Mm-hmm.
I was a clown. It wasn't nothing like... I wanted to crack jokes. I remember my ninth grade year of high school, and this is the fact. The people, I can pull the people up. Jacoby Richardson. It was Jacoby Richardson. Jacoby Richardson was the class clown. He was the one, nobody picked that because he always would make people shut down, make people cry. Like, he was that guy. He was the jokester mm-hmm. at the high school.
Right.
So the next year, I'm going to high school.
Uh-huh.
I was at former elementary. Former middle school. He was at Airport High. So the next year, I'm getting ready to go to high school. Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to high school. I done defeated everybody at middle school. Oh, they ain't gonna fuck with me cracking no jokes at middle school.
Okay.
So I leave there. It's tacky day. It's like the third day of school, and it's tacky day.
Okay.
So you get to wear whatever the fuck you want.
I forgot about them theme days.
I didn't have no clothes.
All your shit was tacky.
I didn't have no clothes. My shit was already tacky. So I was dressed normal at this motherfucker. Everybody else had some other shit on. But nigga, I was normal. And they were like, oh shit, Jake, I see you tacky day. You flexing on tacky day. I'm like, yeah, bitch. You know what I'm saying? I was tacky every motherfucking day.
He's so stupid.
It was normal. It was normal for me to be tacky. I was like, shit, it's all good. So me and Jacoby Richardson, we met in the breezeway.
Okay.
It's a crowd of people. It's crowd. It's crowded. Everybody looked fucked up. You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
I'm normal. You know what I mean? So he started talking about me. I started talking about him.
Uh-huh.
Oh, we back and forth. He don't know that I watch Def Comedy Jam every fucking day.
All right.
That's what I watched on TV, comedy. She can't joke on me. So we out there, we back and forth. He's talking about my clothes. His dad has a child. My youngest sister is by his dad, okay?
Okay.
But me and him don't. We never got along like that. You know what I'm saying? I ain't never looked. Nigga, you ain't my brother. Your daddy is my mama, baby daddy. You ain't my goddamn brother.
Mm-hmm.
So we going back and forth. We joking on each other. And I told one joke that I heard on Def Comedy Jam.
Okay.
And shit, the breezeway down. When I tell you the teachers was out there, because we were going back and forth the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
The resource officers, they didn't break this up. Like, this was an epic moment in high school.
Right.
They didn't break this up. So the joke I told, because he was very dark-skinned. Mm-hmm. He was a black motherfucker. He was black as shit.
Mm-hmm.
And I told him, I said, you so black, you got to wear white gloves to eat Tootsie Rolls so you don't show your fingers off. When I said that shit, listen, when I said that shit, everybody was like, oh, shit. So that's what made me not get bullied, because what I used to wear and what I had, my hair was always nappy. They would have bullied me, but they realized that, okay, this we can't bully this motherfucker here. Because if you bully him, he's going to make a fool out of your ass.
Right. You're going to be crazy.
I'm a little crazy. So I grew up like that. You know what I'm saying? Uh-huh. The only reason I didn't get bullied is because I knew how to crack fucking jokes.
Right. So you got them. You got them that way before they could get you. So nobody trying to be publicly embarrassed.
Yeah. I'm in school. Everybody trying to figure out who feet stink. I know it's my feet. I'm sitting with these stink motherfuckers.
It was your
feet. It was my feet. So there's always a motherfucker in the class that smells something and got to announce the shit. Ooh. What is that? I smell corn chips.
That corn chip.
I ain't got nail sock on. You know what I'm saying? So I got on British Knights with no fucking sock.
I forgot about BKs.
So I'm sitting there acting like it ain't me. You know what I'm saying? And but when she look at me, she look down. She see I ain't got no socks on. I got no shirt. And she look, and I look at her like, yeah, bitch, do it. Do it. I tell you to do it. That's who I was. So, I mean, I got kicked out of school in the, what grade was I in? I was in the 11th grade when I got kicked out of school. This guy, I was in school suspension. This guy named Bobby Ganey.
Okay.
Just how I got kicked out. I'm taking you through the life, my story.
You're going on the journey. This life-changing moment. Just one thing. Series of one thing.
Okay. All right. So I'm in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And I ended up going to, y'all good. I ended up going to ISS. I was in school suspension.
Mm-hmm.
And I was a clown. I was just in there talking shit. I will... probably 90 pounds soaking wet with bricks in my damn shoes. I was small. And this guy named Bobby Ganey, I never forget. Bobby Ganey, I was in there cracking jokes. The ISS teacher, Miss Corley,
mm-hmm.
She was laughing because I was saying all kind of crazy shit. I was blurting out shit like I had Tourette, nigga. I was just blurting shit out. And Miss Corley, she was laughing and shit. She said, boy, you so crazy. You see my friend on Facebook right now. She said, boy, you so crazy. You so crazy. And Bobby got mad because when you're in ISS, you're sitting in cubicles.
Okay. Okay.
So he's in the cubicle right next to mine.
Mm-hmm.
So he told me, he said, man, why don't you shut up, man? I said, you shut up like that. Mm-hmm. Bobby, big dude. Bobby supposed to be... Bobby was too big to be in school.
Not too big to be in school.
Yeah. Bobby D. So, I'm like, Bobby, you shut up. You know what I'm saying? Because I wasn't no pushover now.
Right.
So, I heard the desk, the old desk. You remember the desk? You got the slide in that motherfucker.
Mm-hmm. You got sliding from the side. Yeah. This straighten up. Uh-huh.
So... them desks was kind of old, so you can hear them motherfuckers when you're moving in them. You can hear them squeaking and shit. So I heard his desk squeak. This big motherfucker getting out the desk. I'm like, why he getting out the desk? I'm thinking to myself, why Bobby getting out the desk? I'm not comfortable with this shit. So Bobby get out the desk, I see this nigga head over the cubicle. So I'm like, oh, shit. So Bobby get out. Bobby say, if you say something else, I'm going to beat your ass. I get my little ass up.
Mm-hmm.
Walk around the cubicle. I look Bobby Gaynor straight in his face. I said, you ain't going to do shit to me. Bobby say something else. I say, something else. I don't remember nothing but waking up in the principal's office. After that. No. The only thing I do remember
mm-hmm.
is when he put his hand around my neck.
I'm drinking hot tea.
Yeah. I remember when he put his hand around my neck. After that, I don't remember nothing. So when I wake up in the principal office, when I wake up, my mama is sitting beside me.
Okay.
I look at her and she's giggling. She laughing for, you know what I'm saying? Bobby and his mom over here. So it's a mirror. It's a mirror in the principal's office. It's a mirror. It's not directly behind the principal, but it's right to the right of Mr. Keister. That's his name, Mr. Keister. It's a mirror on the right side. So the only way I can see myself, because I felt weird like a motherfucker, the only way I can see myself is to get up and look. So Mr. Keister is talking. Now, I don't know what done went on because I was knocked the fuck out. So I was like, shit. I was like, I don't know. I said he was talking trash to me. I was talking trash back. I said, all I remember is him putting his hand around my neck. And after that, I woke up in him. My mama started laughing again. I keep saying, what the fuck is she laughing for? You know what I'm saying? She thought that she was funny. But she, I can tell she was mad at the same time. So they talking. So he told Bobby he's suspended for 5 days. I'm suspended for 5 days because we fought. My mama said, is that all he gonna get for blacking my son's eyes?
Like both your eyes.
I said, my ass black. I don't know. Because I haven't seen myself. I know I just fell asleep in the motherfucker sitting in the office. So I got up a little bit and looked in the mirror. I said, this motherfucker but choke me out and then beat the shit out of me. Both my eyes are black like a motherfucker. So we got suspended for 5 days.
He choked you out and then beat you.
He choked me out. He whipped my ass. I said, damn, what the fuck is this? So
somebody said die.
So 5 days. 5 days went by. Uh-huh. And my cousins didn't know what happened. Uh-huh. And they came to me, they told me, you can't let this shit go. Mm-hmm. You can't let this go. You gotta get this motherfucker back. I said, yeah. Cause the family I grew up in, you fucked it up. We gonna get you back. We gonna get you back.
Were they gonna help That's you? Up. Or they wanted you to go out there with the windmill? I mean, how was it going to go? Yeah. How was it going to play out?
I thought these motherfuckers going to help me.
Okay.
Until they saw Bobby. See, they didn't see Bobby. They didn't see Bobby. And we was all talking. We was in the circle. Oh, we ain't going for this shit. We go, yeah. We going to get his ass cooked. Go down to Roger. Roger was the Indian man that owned the Zippy Mart at the bottom of the hill. Mm-hmm. We had a store at the bottom of the hill. That's the only store we had. Uh-huh. Roger stole the little bead necklaces. The little bead necklaces. And it was knives. He had little pocket knives just big with holes in them that you could put around the necklace. So I bought two knives. I bought one at first, walked out the store. And I'm like, Bobby, big motherfucker. Give me one more.
I get one more.
Give me one more knife. Yeah, I only got one more knife. So I put two knives around my neck and I told my cousin, I said, yeah, we gonna get this motherfucker. So we coming around, me and my cousin, we coming down the hallway like an entourage. And I told him, I said, when the first bell ring, we gonna fuck Bobby up. I said, we gonna fuck Bobby up. I said, when the first bell ring, we fucking Bobby up. I was in Miss Pace class. I never forget. I was in Miss Pace class, and the bell rang. Dude, they had a bell ring at school. You know what I'm saying? So the bell rang. I said, oh, yeah, it's time. I look at my cousin. We in class. All us, all my cousins was in alternative school. All us was there.
All y'all been put out for different reasons.
All us was fucked up. So after the bell ring, when the bell rang, I walked out of the class. My cousins walked behind me. I got cousins coming out the other room. Uh-huh. They said, where he at, cub? When they said, where he at? Bobby walked that goddamn classroom. When Bobby walked to that classroom, I said, there he go. When I said, there he go, I turned around. My cousins, one of them bitches left a shoe.
You stupid.
One of them motherfuckers left a shoe. When I tell you, them motherfuckers were leaving him, I looked down that hall, I said, oh my God. When Bobby walked around that corner, them motherfuckers left me in the hall by myself. So I
with a little necklaces.
Yeah. So I reach in my shirt. Motherfucker, I got something.
You got something for him.
Yeah, and again, Bobby's standing there breathing. Like, I can see the breath coming out of this nigga's mouth. This nigga was breathing hard. I said, motherfucker, hold on, stay right there. I got something for you, motherfucker.
I put a nigga. Stay right there.
Yeah, I said, stay right there.
It's the same person that choked you out.
I popped the bead chain, and I took both of the knives, I opened both of the knives up. I said, motherfucker, I'm going to fuck you up. I got you. Windmill time. I went straight at him windmilling with the knives in my goddamn hand. Straight windmill. He hold his hands up so he can get cut in the face. But I cut his arms, all his arms, I cut
him. Wow.
When he blocked, I cut him down. Like, right now, if he pull his shirt up, I split him open. From the bottom of his chest all the way down to his stomach.
My God.
I was scared fighting, though. I was scared fighting. I wasn't fighting because I wasn't dangerous. I was fucking scared.
Yeah, you were trying to save your life.
Yeah, this motherfucker liked to kill me before. So I did all that shit. And when I did that, the police was coming down the hall.
Right.
Because they had to turn the key. Because they put the key in the box. This alternative school. Anything can happen. That was like being in jail. But you can go home at the end of the day.
Right.
West Columbia police running toward me wide open. And when they're running toward me, they see the knives in my hand, you know what they're going for. They're going for the gun. Put them down.
Wow.
My principal, Mr. Keister, came from the side hall and grabbed me with the knives in my hand. Because they love me. The teachers, the principal, they always love me. I don't give a fuck what school I went to. So Mr. Keister grabbed me and said, I got him. And he whispered in my ear. He said, drop the fucking knives. Just like that. I dropped. Mr. Keister said, I got it. Took me to the office. I'm a minor. They can't lock me up.
Right. So you still about, 14 or so? You still around 14 or so?
I was 16.
Okay, 16. Okay.
So they took me to the office. I got to the office. My mama came. My mama called my daddy. My daddy has lawyers because he still, even though he got on drugs, as I got older, he was maintaining. He still had money. He still had lawyers. He still had that shit. You know what I'm saying? So I remember my lawyer name was the same name as mine. His name is Jake Moore.
Wow.
So Jake Moore came to the school. And I don't know what they did. They handled shit. And I went home. But I had a court date. But I was expelled from school.
Wow.
Went to court. And my mama in court, my daddy, the lawyer, everybody's there. And the judge went over the stuff and did the thing and said, well, all right, we're about to render the verdict, the sentence.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying, I know what sentence means. Sentence means you didn't tell me how much time I got.
Right.
16 years old. So they said they gave me 15 years and I had to do 2 years in DJJ and I got to do 13 years in prison.
Wow.
For what I did.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I woke up in my daddy's van because I passed out in the courtroom again.
My God.
See, Jake Moore, the lawyer, knew the judge. They did the shit on purpose. They planned that to tell me this because I seriously was. But I passed out again in the courtroom and woke up in my daddy's van. And when I woke up, I was like, where the fuck am I at? And we were headed to Swans. And that's when I went back with my dad again. I went to stay with my dad again.
Okay.
I didn't go to high school anymore after that.
You were done.
Done.
Wow.
I went to
Did you ever have to do any time, though? Did they ever really make you do time, or?
No. Okay. I didn't do any time. Because he either, I could have pressed charges. The lawyer was going to press charges on Bobby Gainey's parents for what he did to me.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to be, all right, if y'all going to press charges, we're going to press charges.
Right.
And Bobby going to jail. You know what I'm saying? They don't want their son to go to jail, so I didn't get to go. I didn't have to go to jail. But
right.
My dad had to pay like $40,000-$50,000 or something like that to the lawyers. So that kept me out of prison.
Right.
I think that my dad had lied so much, so I don't think he paid that much money because that nigga ain't had no $40,000-$50,000 to give up like that. I think he lied to me. So I think he just did a favor because he built all that man shit. So my dad was lying like a motherfucker. He ain't spent that much money. But I did that, and that's how I got out of high school. I went back to adult ed and realized why I got put out of school. Fuck that. You know what I mean? Right. I tell my kids, go to school, get your education.
Right.
You know, my kids think I graduated.
Because you be giving speeches about education.
Yeah. So my kid think that. They think that diploma is mine. I don't ever. Come on now.
Well, who's diploma?
That's my high school life. That's my high school life. And then once I got out of high school.
No, you said they think it's your diploma. Did you get a GED? Like, what do they think is a diploma?
I got a printout of a certificate.
I can't stand
when
you.
No, listen. I got a little certificate. Y'all don't judge me.
This I'm not judging. This is a judge-free zone. This is the late night edition of it is of just one thing, life-changing moments. That's what we're doing right now. Late night edition. That's what we're doing. No judgment. We just listening. We listening.
Okay. So that's high school. You got any more questions?
No, go ahead. That's high school.
Okay. That's high school. I got out of high school. I worked with my dad for a while in the construction field. Did that, realized that I'm not a construction ass nigga.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not that dude to go out here and lift no board and build no house. No, I ain't that nigga.
Okay.
Nah. So I used to hide up under the house all motherfucking day while they building because I couldn't do that shit.
Not so that's the house.
Yeah. It was too hot out there. I couldn't work out there in that weather.
Not too hot.
But, yeah. I was back and forth trying to find, I was young.
Uh-huh.
So I started clubbing and I started gangbanging when I was 19. Mm-hmm. I joined the Folks.
Okay.
The gang called Folks.
Mm-hmm.
So when I joined the gang, I didn't know exactly what I was doing.
Okay.
Now I'm a gang member. This was on a Tuesday. By Wednesday evening, I wasn't in the gang no more. I'm going to tell you what happened.
Okay.
No, this is serious shit. I'm going to tell you what happened. So when you get in the gang, you got to do some gang shit.
Right. I'm saying so right like I know. I'm like, right.
They were beefing.
Mm-hmm.
I am innocent. They were beefing with another gang. So they say, okay, Jake, come on. You want to be in the gang? Mm-hmm. Come on. Put your ass, motherfucker. You finna do some gang shit.
Right.
So I'm riding in a box Chevy. I never forget. I'm in the back. It's the middle of the summertime. This box Chevy ain't got no motherfucking air condition. I'm in the back. It smelled like premium gasoline in this motherfucking box shit.
Mm-hmm.
So the guy sitting to my left handed me a 357 Magnum. He said, here you go. I said, what this for? You know what I'm saying? He said, well, you're going to have to shoot. When we pull up, you're going to have to shoot.
Mm-hmm.
I said, damn. I know the consequences of fucking up because I just been in some shit. Well, I'm about to get 15 years in fucking jail.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, damn, I got to get out of this car. Now I'm thinking like old boy on Boys in the Hood, like, let me out. I want to say let me out so bad. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I can't. So when we got to where we were going, jumped out the car, they start shooting. These motherfuckers shooting back. I threw the gun toward them.
Like, here go another one.
I took the gun and threw the gun at one of the motherfuckers shooting. Ooh. I turned around and broke out of range. I'm like, what the fuck? No. So by the time they caught back up with me, I said, oh, they're going to beat my ass. I already know they're going to beat my ass. They came back. They let me off. They laughed. I made them laugh. That's what my gift was. I can make people laugh.
You made gang members laugh.
I made these motherfuckers laugh.
Do you remember anything you said to them? Because they should have killed you. I mean, I'm on your side, but I'm saying that's just how I heard it go.
Nigga, I don't remember exactly how it went. I was in Swansea. Uh-huh. I don't remember how it went. But I just knew that was my last time. I said, this was game shit. This ain't for me. So, skip past that.
Mm-hmm.
I got to make some money. I don't know what to do. I'm 20 years old. I don't know. Now I'm 20. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to do. I need to make some money.
Right.
So, in order for me to make money, either I got to, you know, go to work, or I got to sell dope from where I come from.
Mm-hmm.
So, I wanted my cousin to teach me how to sell dope. My cousin sold dope.
Mm-hmm.
So, my cousin had this Regal. Nice Regal. Might be a 1985, 86 Regal.
Mm-hmm.
Call him G-Money. I was in the car with G-Money. Me and G-Money riding. G-Money telling me the ins and outs of this shit. Mm-hmm. Telling me, look here you go. G-Money gave me $20 in my hand. He now give me the $20 back. I said, huh? You want $20 back? Yeah. I'm a sell you some product. So he sold. I gave him $20. He gave me enough product to make $40.
Okay.
I said, oh shit. So you teach me how to do the game. So okay. One day it was me, G Money, plus a couple more of my cousins in the car. We riding. I'm the driver. I'm the only one got a driver's license. Everybody in here said dope.
Mm-hmm.
So they said, this is your initiation. You got to do some work, some manual labor, nigga.
Mm-hmm.
So we riding this shit. We in West Columbia. I'll never forget.
Mm-hmm.
Going to goddamn do a serve. I'm like, shit, I can deal with this shit. I mean, this simple shit. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And he got HP in this motherfucker. That cool there. So we turned on the dirt road, and I never forget. I saw the police turn around in my rearview mirror.
Mm-hmm.
I said, I hope this motherfucker ain't come behind us. By the time I turned on the dirt road, here come West Columbia police. Turn on the dirt road.
Wow.
Threw the lights on us.
Uh-huh.
My cousin look at me in the back seat. My cousin said, listen, you ain't got no drug charges, cool. I got a pocket full of dope. He said, I'm going to give you my dope. I'm going to give you my dope, and you're going to be out of jail tomorrow. What we call is a PR bond down here. PR bond is you get out of jail on personal recognizance or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you don't have to pay no money. You get right back out of jail. That's what a PR bond is here.
Okay.
So my cousin told me, you're going to get out on a PR bond. I'm like, shit. I didn't know what the fuck it was. I said, okay. He said, yeah, because you'll be right back out of jail on the PR tomorrow. He said, but I'm giving you this dope. This is your first offense. You ain't going to do no time.
Mm-hmm.
I said, okay. So by this time, the police is coming. And you know, when they come to the car, they always pack the back of the car for some fucking reason.
Mm-hmm.
So when the police pack the back of the car, my cousin look at me again in the mirror. My cousin said, listen, you're going to be out of jail tomorrow, cool. PR bond. Tell me. I said, okay. Police came to the window. I let the window down. Police said, son, I need your license registration. So I reached in the glove box, I got my registration out of there, gave my license. I asked police. I said, Mr. Police, I got a question. He said, what's up? I said, what is a PR bond? My cousin kicking the back of my motherfucking seat. Like, what the fuck you doing, cuz? So the police look at me. Police is like, why you asking me about a PR bond? What you talking about? I said, well, my cousin said he going to give me the dope he got, and y'all going to let me out tomorrow.
I can't stand
on the
you.
PR bond. So this shit happened. So Everybody got locked up.
You trying to verify it.
I was verifying what the fuck you were telling, because you niggas be lying. So I had to verify this nigga wasn't lying. So everybody went to jail. But I got out the next day on a fucking PR bar. So it was true, but I didn't get no drug charges. I'm just saying. I'm just saying.
Ain't nobody playing with you.
I'm just saying. That's what happened.
Oh my God,
bro.
I can't stand you.
So that part of my life, I was like, fuck. So now, got me hollering at work. Don't holler at work. Now I'm 21.
Okay.
So now I get my cousin. I was sitting on my mom's porch. I never forget. My cousin came up the hill. He was already driving truck. So mm-hmm. My cousin said, listen, man, you can't sit here and not do shit. You got to do something with yourself. So he took me to the truck stop. The truck stop got books to tell you what company to hire.
Right.
So I got a book. I called the first company I saw on the front page. Mm-hmm. First company on the front page said Swift Driving Academy. I called them motherfuckers. They told me, we seen your bus ticket this week. Come on.
Mm-hmm.
I said, dang. So I went to Greer first.
Okay.
Greer, South Carolina. Got my CDL permit. We left Greer, got on the bus, went to Richmond, Virginia.
Mm-hmm.
To do the road test and do the classes to learn how to drive truck.
Mm-hmm.
Got back to South Carolina, did the driving test, got my CDL license. Been driving 16 years ever since, and now I'm an owner operator.
Wow.
So I've been an owner operator four times. Just the fifth time I've been an owner operator now. Mm-hmm. Ain't gonna be number goddamn six.
Right.
So what do you want? You wanna pause? You got some more questions?
So now I wanna know. You walked us through your childhood, your crazy teenage years, hilarious. You walked us through learning quickly, being in a gang and out of a gang in less than 24 hours. You walked us through learning how to sell drugs briefly and how to, hold a meeting with the police. You walked us through that. I want to know, I mean, you're hilarious. Comedy got you out of a lot of stuff. Comedy helped you navigate your pain. I want to know, when did you decide to step on stage the first time? Like, when did it go from saving your life, becoming, a way for people to get off your back all through, being a kid and everything, to I'm going to step on a stage? When did that happen?
So all my life, people been telling me, Jake, you're a comedian. Jake, you do comedy. Jake, you're a comedian. You need to do comedy. Man, listen, you need to try this. Go to. So I got married in 2014, mm-hmm. I think. I got married in 2014. And at that time, we had rent a building for our reception.
Okay.
And my wife kept beating in my head, man, you need to try comedy. You need to do comedy. You need to do comedy. So 2014, I said, you know what? I already done rent this building. I'm going to see if he got a date that I can get that it ain't rented, that I can just do a little show real quick.
Okay.
So I talked to the guy. He said, man, yeah. He said, next Saturday, whatever, whenever.
Uh-huh.
So I got the building on a Saturday. I said, fuck it, I'm going to try comedy.
Wait, so you did a whole show to try comedy? You decided to produce a whole show to try comedy?
Wow. Yes.
Not open mic.
I didn't know it.
Not open mic. You just, okay. Okay.
I didn't know.
Okay, I love it. I'm just listening.
Yeah. I said, fuck it. Give me a building. Mm-hmm. So I invited a lot of people, but I didn't expect a lot of people to come.
Okay. Okay.
So I thought maybe 15 to 20 people would show up, when we bullshit around or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I got this show. I went to the liquor store. I bought liquor. for a bar. So I bought like a pint of CC, a pint of gin, and a couple of pints of some other shit that was cheap as fuck. I probably spent $25 on liquor on the bar.
Okay, on the bar.
My wife made pimento cheese sandwiches and goddamn.
Not pimento cheese. Damn, I haven't heard that in so long.
Look at cutting them shits up in squares like a motherfucker.
Making hors d'oeuvres.
I had I had little bowls of potato chips. Because I want people to be comfortable. Now, I don't have a DJ. I don't have a host. I don't have a feature. I don't know these things.
Okay.
I don't know these things. So, now it's showtime. It's damn near 80 people in this motherfucker. They paid $5 to get in here to see me.
Wow.
Do comedy.
Wow.
Where the fuck did all these people come from?
That's what
I'm like. Where the fuck did I said, where did people come from? I said, shit. So the show started at 8. It's going on 9:55. Ain't no comedy in this. Ain't no show yet. Everybody waiting. So after a while, motherfuckers like, okay, we ready to see some comedy. So my cousin tapped me, cuz, listen, man. I said, cuz, I don't have nothing. I don't know what the fuck to say. I don't even have a microphone. What the fuck am I going to go do? So I went
you
on stage.
You had these thoughts after you planned the show.
I had these thoughts while the show was going on. The show was already going on. So I went up on the stage. I said, fuck it. I went up on the stage. I said, hey, everybody, I don't have nothing to say. Get your $5 back at the door, and I'll try this shit again next time. That's what I said. They're like, oh, man, come. I'm like, shh. So it was no show. Nobody took their money back. Nobody took the money back. Everybody kept telling me, man, but just keep trying. Motherfucker, I didn't do nothing at all, period. So I told my wife, I'd never do this shit again. I'd never do this shit again.
So you didn't say anything at all? Like, you didn't try to, like, tell a little story or anything?
All I did was I tried to imitate a guy from the neighborhood that talked funny. And that was it. And after that, I was like, what the fuck? I done fucked up. You know what I mean?
Wow.
So, yeah, it was horrible. Horrible experience. I told my wife, I got mad with her. I came back in the house and she talked me into this bullshit. So I came back in the house, I had them fucking pimento cheese sandwiches on the plate and I threw them shits at. You tried to get embarrassed the shit out of me. They had pimento cheese all over the fucking place in the living room. So at the time before I put my marble floors in, I had carpet in this motherfucker. So she had pimento cheese all in the damn carpets in this motherfucker. But fast forward to 2017.
Okay.
It was, I never forget, because I told her I wasn't doing this shit no more.
Uh-huh.
In 2017, me and my wife was in the bed. It was like November. It's like right before Thanksgiving, I think. Mm-hmm. And she looked at me. She said, you need to give comedy another shot. Because I'm still making people laugh at every goddamn cookout we go to. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So she said, you need to give comedy another shot. I was like, you know, I will. I said, I make a promise to you that 2018, I'll give it a shot. 2018 roll around, January. She ain't say nothing. I ain't say nothing. February, she done heard an ad on the radio that Columbia's Got Talent. Got a talent show at the comedy house.
Okay.
So she came in the house. She's like, look, they got a comedy show at the comedy. They got a talent show at the comedy house. You need to sign up for that shit. I said, I'll call down there next month. So I ended up calling February anyway. I called the radio station. Stevie answered the phone. Stevie, my homeboy right now. Stevie answered the phone. I didn't know them at this time.
Okay.
So when he answered the phone, he was like, yo, I mean, I was like, hey, I'm calling to see if I can get on the March show, talent show, for Columbia's Got Talent. He was like, man, we got a spot for you now, this month. You can do it this month. I was like, okay, fuck it. Sign me up. I said, when is the show? He said, tomorrow. I said, oh, shit. You know, now I'm like, oh. I said, no, I can't. He said, come on, man, you got a spot. He said, come on, we add it to the list. He hung up. Boop. He didn't even give me time to say no.
Right.
So now you done put my name on here. So I said, fuck. I said, I got to do something. I said, because the last time I did, I ain't had nothing to talk about, so I got to find something to talk about. Right. Immediately, I went to the TV, and I looked up comedy. I'm looking at all the comedy. I'm looking at YouTube. I'm looking at all this shit. I'm looking at stand-up Bernie. I'm looking at Bernie. I'm looking at George. I'm looking at fucking Tony Rock, Chris Rock. I'm looking at all Mike Epps. I'm looking at all these legendary comedians that's beasts out here. Uh-huh. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I'm like, damn, we put a story together. So I say, you know what? I go on there and I talk about how I grew up. I talk about my mom, shit like that. Mm-hmm. So I went out that shit out there and I just told a true story about my mom.
Mm-hmm.
And how my mom used to help with homework, help you get every fucking thing wrong, and still cut your ass because the teacher called her dumb. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I made these people laugh, but I lost. I didn't win.
Okay.
In February. So the judges, before I lost, the judges, Keisha Martin, Felicia, I call her Fifi Versace, Derek Worland, mm-hmm. and she's the coroner of Richland County right now, Nada Rutherford.
Okay.
She's the coroner of Richland County. She was a judge.
They and all them told the judges.
Huh?
They just pick people to be judges, whether they knew about comedy and talent or not.
Yeah, yeah. They just pick people to be judges. Now, mm-hmm. Keisha Martin knows everything about talent because she's the director of marketing for the biggest radio station here.
Okay, got you. So, okay.
Keisha Martin said, listen, if you don't win tonight, you make sure you come back next month. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. Tony was a singer. He sung Tank song, When We. I never forget. And the nigga built all kind of shit. And he's singing, When We. He doing all the movements. He taking his shirt off. The nigga nipples hard than the motherfucker. When We. I said, God damn. And he sang, all the women went crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So it was down to me and him on the stage to see who win. Tony won.
Okay. I said,
fuck. So I'm cool with it. Dede Renee is the host.
Okay.
Dede Renee is the host. So they told me to come back next month. I said, okay. I said, yeah. They said, we can go ahead and sign you up now. You ain't got to worry about it. You come back next month. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. So I said, you know what? I know Tony going to come back next month again. Because he that type of nigga. He want to keep winning.
All right.
So I'm like, okay. So I said, fuck it. I did a photo shoot.
Mm-hmm.
What's his name? Marquise. That's his name. Marquise is an awesome photographer. I did a photo shoot with Marquise. Marquise took a bunch of photos of me. And we had like a little photo shoot party.
Okay.
But now my mind is saying, I'm gonna fucking do comedy. Mm-hmm. This is what I'm gonna do.
Okay.
So I did a photo shoot and I got t-shirts. And I started promoting the show for next month.
Right.
I'm gonna be at the Comedy House. When I tell you, everybody bought my t-shirts out.
Oh, so you started doing marketing. Out. You started doing merch.
Yes.
Oh wow.
Quick.
Okay.
Sold out t-shirts. I ain't never did comedy. That was my second time doing comedy.
Right.
I'm selling merchandise.
Mm-mm.
Sold out t-shirts. Started a company that's running right now called Loudmouth Entertainment.
Wow.
I went and got my LLCs for Loudmouth Entertainment.
Mm-hmm.
Sold all those t-shirts.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody I sold a t-shirt, I sold 50, 60 t-shirts. Every last person that bought a t-shirt came to the show the next month and more. Mm-hmm. I sold out a talent show on a fucking Thursday night at the Comedy House. This is a fact. Mm-hmm. Loudmouth Entertainment shirts were all over the building.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So when I got on stage, now it's March. Now it's tax time.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm talking about tax time. I'm talking about how we going to go buy a car. We're going to put down $3,000 with a fucking 38% interest rate.
Okay.
And we ain't going to never pay the payment. The shit going to get repoed in July. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I'm just doing this, but the crowd, the shit I'm saying ain't that funny. But I had my crowd with me. So everything I said, they were falling out of the chairs laughing.
Mm-hmm.
Falling out the chairs laughing. And when I got off the stage, everybody stood up and gave me the biggest standing ovation ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
Standing ovation, hollering and screaming. So when they came, another comedian came out, they booed him. They didn't even let him open his mouth. When he came out on stage, uh-huh. What's up, Columbia? Boo! All over the building. All over the building. Ooh, I was like, oh shit, my people crazy as shit.
Right.
So Tony came back and bought his daughter. His daughter could fucking sing.
Mm-hmm.
He could sing. So it's back down to me and Tony again.
Okay.
But before I got off the stage, I knew Tony was there. Mm-hmm. I was the last act. Tony sung before me. So before I got off the stage, this is how I closed my show out. I said, last month, Tony came and took his motherfucking shirt off. And had y'all in here screaming. I went backstage, and I had the mic in my hand. I said, DJ, drop it. I made him play Tank, Win We. When I came back on the stage, I ain't have no shirt on. And I started singing that shit, and they went crazy. Not only did I win... But they gave me a job at the hottest radio station in Columbia.
Look at God, what are you doing?
They gave me a job at Big DM being the host of Columbia's Got Talent.
Wow.
I became the host that night of Columbia's Got Talent. I hosted that shit for a year.
Mm-hmm.
Now, once I did that, that's when I started really taking comedy serious. I started writing and learning comedy, learning time and learning all this, learning all that. So I started opening up at the Comedy House. The Comedy House hired me to open up and host for a whole year straight after that. I was hosting at the Comedy House. I was hosting other places and doing this. And then the first person I opened up for, God rest his soul, was Tyler Craig.
Wow. Tyler was a beast.
Oh, God. I opened up for Tyler Craig first. Mm-hmm. And Tyler Craig was one of the nicest comedians I ever met. Tyler didn't know. I mean, I told him this is my first time ever opening up at the Comedy House.
Mm-hmm.
So I froze up. The first show, I froze up. When on stage, I froze up. I said, God damn, I ain't got nothing to talk about. You know what I'm saying? I'm up there. I ain't got shit to talk about. How y'all doing? Nigga over here said, you done asked us that shit 3 times. Fuck. I was like, I don't shit. So I'm looking. Tyler Craig is standing in my view.
Uh-huh.
When I tell you Tyler Craig is standing right there in the light. I can see him, and he's shaking his head like, you getting killed, nigga. You know what I'm saying? So I say, fuck it. I'm going to tell some knock-knock jokes. Tyler Craig yell across the room, no, nigga, not the knock-knock jokes. I said, fuck. So I stayed in that fire. I talked to that audience. I did my time. That what mattered. I didn't run. Right. I stood there and I did my time.
Right.
I stood there and did my time. And I got off the stage, and when I introduced Tyler, I didn't see him.
Okay.
I was like, where the fuck is Tyler? So I walked out the back door backstage. Tyler is on two knees laughing like a motherfucker at me. He said, hold on, nigga, hold on. I can't go out there right now. He said, go back out there. Go back out there and tell him I'm coming. I said, mm-mm, I can go back out there, motherfucker. So when I told him, I ain't go back out there, he started laughing harder. So he was like, man, you got to introduce me again. He bet they crying. You got to introduce me again. I went back out there. I said, y'all, Tyler was coming, but he backstage laughing at me so motherfucking hard, he can't stand up. They start laughing like a motherfucker. The crowd went crazy. They start laughing. I said, yeah, this motherfucker back here laughing. I said, he's spitting up and crying, laughing at me because I ain't got no motherfucker. Now I'm out there doing comedy, don't even know it.
Wow.
So they killing themselves laughing. Now Tyler opens the door and says, okay, nigga, introduce me now. So I introduced Tyler. He came out there. Uh-huh. I thought that was it for me. Mm-hmm. So I walked back around and I sat in the chair. Tyler said, hey, put the spotlight on this nigga right here. I didn't know he was talking about me.
Right.
They said, who? He pointed at me. Him. And when he put the spotlight on, he tore my ass up for 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. After the show, Tyler gave me some pointers. The rest of that weekend, I tore their ass up. My first time opening up.
Wow.
Ever since then, I opened up for John Witherspoon, mm-hmm. Don D.C. Curry, Tony Roberts, Tony Rock, Mike Epps, Jess Hilarious, Desi Banks, D.C. Young Fly. I done opened up for every fucking big name you could think of.
Well,
George Wilborn. I want to say George Wilborn last mm-hmm. because I have a special story about George.
Okay.
And you know some of what it is.
Okay.
So I opened up for George Wilborn. It was in my first year of comedy. Opened up for George. And George, oh, before that, I'm sorry, I'm skipping. And within that year, I got booked at the Township Auditorium. I'll go to Georgia in a minute. Okay. I got booked at the Township Auditorium to open up for Tyrese and Kate Michelle.
Wow.
I was like, oh, shit. I got all the videos and shit. Mm-hmm. This was the first time in my life mm-hmm. I ever shit up myself. Now, let me finish.
We're going to let you finish, I guess, the story.
Yeah. So I really shit up myself at this show. So I'm backstage. And Cadillac and Puff on stage to, Cadillac, Puff, and Beezy Baby on the stage. And they introducing me. Mm-hmm. So they're like, hey, this your homeboy. He from right here in Columbia, South Carolina. I want y'all to give it up for comedian Jake Staley. And when they drop my music, when I'm nervous, mm-hmm. before every show, I develop gas for some reason. So I'm already pooping. I didn't know I was down to my last two poops. I didn't know that. So when I did the last two poops, I'm like, okay, good. When I went to walk on stage, I said, oh, it's one more. And I went to push. When I push, baby, that was shit. That was boo-boo. I didn't know it was boo-boo. So I boo-boo up myself. It was one little boo-boo. It was a little baby. It wasn't but this big. But it shot out. So I said, fuck. I got on white pants. I had on white. I'm going to send you the video. You'll see it. Because I stepped and I stopped. Like, oh, shit. So by the time I got on stage, I done shit. So I'm telling jokes. It's Mother's Day weekend. And this is, I'm telling jokes about my mama because it's Mother's Day. I'm walking around the stage back and forth, done shit. Okay? So when I got finished, I backed all the way off the stage because I didn't know about the stain in the back of my fucking pants. So I was like, y'all have a good night. I backed all the way up to the bathroom. So I went in the bathroom and I threw them drawers in the trash and I went the fuck home. So that was the experience of a lifetime. So I continued to open up for Big X at the Comedy House.
Okay.
And then I met and what I call an angel. Mm-hmm. I met George Wilborn, the stress reliever.
Wow.
I didn't know where this was going at all.
Right.
So I was hosting. I hosted for George Wilborn. And after the show, George got on the phone with me. He made a video. He was like, yo, Columbia, South Carolina, y'all continue to support Jake. Jake, this guy, he going to do something. He going somewhere, whatever. I hadn't seen, and I didn't see George after that for about 2 or 3 years. And he came back to the Comedy House. The Comedy House called me and said, hey, we got a feature spot for you. And by now, I've been developing in comedy because I've been doing shit. I've been doing shows. I've been at the Comedy House. I've been traveling just a little bit, just minor mm-hmm. travel.
Yeah.
Charlotte with some people, and I've been opening up for other people, so other places. So by now, I'm featured. Mm-hmm. So they asked me to come feature for George Wilborn. I said, okay, cool. So George backstage, he talked to his feature. He talked to his host. And he just, you know, kind of get to know you because you want to vibe with you because you're on the show with him, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we back there. He already know me from a couple years ago. I was telling you, featuring now, man. I said, yeah, doing a little something. He said, okay, do your motherfucking thing, bro. I went out there, and I've established a set now.
Okay.
And this was last year.
Mm-hmm.
So I've established a set that is solid. Mm-hmm. So I went out there and did my thing.
Yeah.
And George is watching. George got a distinct laugh. You know George in the building if he's laughing. Because George got a laugh of his own. That's George.
On the phone, too.
Yeah. George laugh over everybody. So, I hear this laugh.
Uh-huh.
I don't know this George. I didn't know this George. I hear this laugh. I said, damn, somebody laughing like a motherfucker. So, after I got off the stage and went backstage, he was waiting on me.
Wow.
He came backstage. And he took his hand in. That's how you do. Boy, you did your motherfucking thing, boy. Da 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 da. And then so I bet they're talking to him. So after I stayed and watched him. So after the show in the green room, he was like, no, I looked at his schedule. This is me, networking. Looking at his schedule. So I see he's going to be in Charlotte the next weekend. So I say, hey, G. Well, I call him George then. I call him G now because we family now, you know.
Right.
So I'm like, George, I see you in Charlotte next week. I said, you know, I don't mind coming up. I said, I ain't want no money. I don't want none of that shit. I just come up and do some stage time. Do, you know what I'm saying? Do a guest spot for you mm-hmm. if I could. He said, you know what? Shit, come to Charlotte next week. I said, okay. I said, well, I'll come do one show, you know what I'm saying? No, he said, no. You can be a guest on all 5 shows.
Wow.
So I said, shit. So I get to Charlotte. The next weekend. I never forget. I walked in when you go to the Comedy Zone in Charlotte. When you walk in, the green room, the ticket booth here, the green room is right there.
Mm-hmm.
So I walk in the green room, George in there. Ah, what's up, boy? You know what I'm saying? Shake my hand and all that. And the feature is there. We in there talking about timing. And I said, yeah, I'm just, and, you know, George said, yeah, Jake going to do a guest spot tonight.
Mm-hmm.
So I went up before the feature.
Okay.
No. George told the feature, I want Jake to be between. No. I'm skipping. First night, I went up before the feature.
Right.
When I went up before the feature, I killed Charlotte.
Mm-hmm.
I killed Charlotte. The feature came up and went down a little bit. I'm not talking about it, but it wasn't as high.
Right. I understand how shows go.
So the rest of the weekend, George went to management. George said, listen, rest of the weekend, I want Jake featuring for me, and y'all feature can do a guest spot. So I'm like, what the f-? You know what I'm saying? I'm
Favor.
So I'm now I'm excited and I'm nervous because I don't know how the teacher feel about what they say a rookie coming in taking his spot. Mm-hmm. So I don't want him to feel a certain way because of the niceness in me. I'm a nice person, so I'm like, damn, I ain't gonna feel bad, but yeah. Shit, this is my shot. Kill Charlotte the rest of the weekend. Get home, and I'm there. George exchanged number with me, and George called me about that Wednesday. He said, "What you have on your schedule for this weekend?" I said, "Man, I ain't got no damn schedule." He said, "How would you like to feature for me at the Baltimore Comedy Factory?" It's November last year.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "How would you like to feature for me at the Baltimore Comedy Factory?" I said, "What?" I said, "Yes, I will feature for you." Ever since then, I've played Baltimore Comedy Factory with George. I've been on the road with George at all these improv, Milwaukee, Chicago, Baltimore. I done been everywhere with this guy.
Wow.
And currently, today, just today, he just booked me for Detroit. Next week, we're in, next week I'm headlining in Augusta, Georgia at Maserati's Event Center. The week after that, we're going to Jackson, Mississippi. Me and George going to Chuckles in Jackson, Mississippi, 5 shows. The week after that, I'm opening up. George is hosting. I'm opening up for Life Jennings, Tank, Carl Thomas at the Township Auditorium in Columbia, South Carolina. The week after that, I'm going to Detroit, Michigan to feature with George at Birch's Theater in Detroit, Michigan. The week after, no, I'm going to skip. The week after the Township, I'm going to headline at Silks in Cleveland, Ohio. I'm headlining. I got 3 shows there. After that, I'm going to Detroit with George. After that, I'm going back to Baltimore with George Wilborn. And my schedule goes on and on and on.
Yeah.
And I did all this. Everybody said, "Jake, how did you do this? How did you do this? How do you continue to go through this comedy and you keep getting booked? You keep getting this. People are looking at you. You got into how you get on Just One Thing with CHAR-TOWN Entertainment? How are you doing all these things? How are you? I said, "Listen, I have one way. I only have one way. I put God first."
Amen.
After that, I have no conversation.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I saw you and I was like, "Who is that?" So I hadn't heard of you because I've been in the house for really 2 years. So I didn't know you before the pandemic. Like, I'm not going. I knew a lot of people, thousands of people before the pandemic. But I was like, "Who's that?" And so I wanted to hear your story. I didn't ask you your story before this interview because I like to hear it live. And I believe in divine order, and I watch and I listen, you know, and you answered really all of my questions because I was going to ask you what's next. You told us what's next. That's how I was going to end it. But I do want to say, I know what greatness looks like. And that's not about you, but it's about how God is going to continue to move through you and your career. You know, I believe in divine order. And when God shows me something, it's never been wrong. You know, and we'll talk about that offline. I think the foundation of one of the greatest comedy specials ever is somewhere in this interview. And so mark my word. And I would say listening to you is, you know, this show, this platform to me is such a blessing. It's become such a blessing. And my main show with It Is What It Is, How Men Think, you know, so I'm booking everybody over there and I'm getting thousands and thousands of views. And I mean, it was like crazy. I'm radio personalities were like, "How are you getting all these people? How are you getting all these people?" I was like, "What do you mean? How I'm getting all these? I'm calling on the cell phone." I mean, with George Wallace, I mean, they were like, "You're just getting people to sit there and talk for an hour and a half." And so that was my main focus during the pandemic, the rebooting of the radio show that I did turning into a Zoom show. But then one night I said, you know, I want to connect somehow with people on YouTube. And I started doing just one thing on YouTube. And God said, do your book, but highlight other people. Highlight their life-changing moments, their journey. And I said, yeah, I'll do that. It'll be just one thing to show. And so then YouTube wasn't getting the traction I wanted. So a few months ago, I switched over to IG. And I said, well, let me see what they talk about on IG and see if I can, you know, start to highlight people. And it was a thing of like such an easy show for me to sit and highlight other people's lives. But it has become the biggest blessing to me for people to candidly share their journeys, you know. And it's a blessing when I have people like, you know, Jeff Mayweather, because I work with the Mayweather family for 7 years, come on and talk about winning 4 international champions, the last woman signed to Motown, Supremes with Motown, Susei Green, and so many legends, Malik Youssef, have come through and talked about their journeys. But it's a bigger blessing when you have someone who is on the precipice of greatness come and sit down and tell you about who God is to them. And so yeah. I feel blessed tonight. I feel blessed that you shared your story with me, that you shared your journey with us. And I saw a lot while I was sitting here listening, you know, and you made me laugh, but I was also taken in by your testimony, and it can't be called anything but a testimony. And so I'm super proud of you. The best is yet to come. Don't stop focusing on God. Don't stop giving, acknowledging God privately, and he's going to elevate you publicly.
Oh, yeah.
You know? And so you don't have to explain your journey to anyone. Just say God is, you know, because you can't explain how things, you know, start to move and unfold. And I was sitting here smiling with pride because even though we just met a couple of weeks ago, I was smiling because I'm on the business side, but that's kind of how my journey happened. We talked about, you know, starting at the top. And I was like, I didn't know there was a bottom floor. You know, I never thought about going down there. But I mean, it was just a matter of, you know, God, anyway, you blessed me. And I feel like you were at that crossroad, you know, where you didn't have anything to lose. You know, I was at a personal crossroad, even though financially I was doing well before entertainment. I didn't have anything to lose, you know, emotionally and spiritually. So I was like, God, anyway, you bless me. I'm cool. You know, and so 26 years later, I never dreamed of having a sports entertainment management company. And I'm saying to you, Jake Staley, you're not going to be able to believe where you're going to be in 5 years. 5 years. The start is coming next year. The launching pad is coming next year. But 5 years, you're not going to believe it.
Hey, I'm like I say, whatever God has for me, I accept it and I'm going with it.
It's coming. It's coming. And so
I do want to thank some people.
Huh?
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I said I want to thank some people.
Okay, go ahead.
The people that's watching now, mm-hmm. I just want to let them know that without them, comedy don't exist. Without Salty by Nature, without Bonnie Chambers, without whoever else is on here, Mr. Cunningham, without Lil B, comedian Lil B, without Paige, you know, without these people, I'm just trying to see who's on here, whoever else is on here, without y'all, what we do don't mean shit. Without y'all, what we do don't mean shit. Because if you don't have people to tell this shit to, it don't mean nothing. So my comedy career is dedicated already to the people. The people, that's why I'm sensitive about when comedians, sometimes comedians don't have time to take a picture with you. Because they are human beings. They got their own life. And just because they say no for a picture don't mean that they think they're better than you are. It just means that right now they don't feel like it. Because you don't always feel like doing certain shit. And if you are a fry cook, you don't feel like doing certain. It don't matter what you do. You don't always feel like doing certain shit.
Mm-hmm.
But I do want to acknowledge the people. That's what I want to do. Mm-hmm. I'm going to always acknowledge the people. Because when I'm in that audience and these people are laughing, and mm-hmm. I haven't done a show yet where they paid to actually see me. Next week will be the first one where they're buying tickets to come see me.
Right.
Well, I did do one. I take that back. But I always acknowledge the people.
Mm-hmm.
Always. I don't give a damn. This live had I think the highest it got about 15 people. That means a lot to me.
Yes.
I don't have to see 1,000 viewers. These people right here are the people that I can probably trust to say good luck.
Mm-hmm.
There's 1,000 people watching and everybody say good luck. I might not can't believe all of them, but mm-hmm. I can almost believe everybody's watching because it's just this. I don't know. I don't know how to explain it, but you know
what I want to say this. I mean, to piggyback on what you're saying, then the number 15 just means that those are 15 people who hung with you and listened to this story, who can also come back to this video when we share it, tag people to watch it because it was a blessing to you. So 15 times 15 is 225, and then you keep multiplying and you keep multiplying, and that's because it's a Saturday night. And I believe that you all, I know you all have the capacity to hit tag your friends, tag 5 people, tag 10 people, you know, so that's 150 times, you know, the 10 people, you know, and keep going and keep going. And that's how it happens, you know. So just because people weren't available to watch the live doesn't mean you can't tag people in the playback. And also, while I'm closing out this show, click follow. Follow Jake, follow CHAR-TOWN ENT, and keep up with this young man. And also tune into the future shows because I got some good ones coming in. I don't just highlight celebrities, you know, I highlight people with a story that I think people need to hear, you know. So tomorrow night we have a young comedian, Lil B, and her testimony, special episode on a Sunday night. Monday, I have another special episode with movie director, comedian, producer, Derek Ellis. He just produced his first movie that is on Amazon Prime, but he's a veteran comedian, been in this game for decades. And so I'm so super proud of him. Thursday, we have recording artist Lavelle. He has a new project out and stuff featuring with Anthony Hamilton, a whole bunch of people. We're talking about his career, his tour, you know, the concert series he's kicking off, as well as the rescheduling of Big Sam from the East Side Boys. He was having technical difficulties with the phone yesterday, but we're rescheduling him for this Friday. And so keep up with me. And coming up soon, the legendary George Wallace is going to sit down and kick it with me. So you all watch, stay tuned in. Got some good shows, good conversations. I don't even call them shows. I don't even call them interviews. Just conversations I want people to hear. And so thank you, Jake Staley. I'm so proud of you, love. Thank you all for hanging. Thank you all for hanging. Tag some people. Let them know this young man exists if they don't already know. You know, get on now. Don't start supporting him when he can't see it and he got 50 million followers. Do it now where he can feel the flowers, where he can feel the love. Do it now where he can see y'all's name and say personally thank you. You know what I mean? Y'all support people who don't know you exist, who can't even see it because it's 50 million people. Tell this young man now that you enjoyed his story. So thank you, guys. Anything else, Jake?
That's it. I appreciate you, Char, for allowing me to be on your platform. You have a lot of major people on your platform, and I feel like you look at me as one of those people, and I appreciate it. And We're gonna talk about some other things offline.
We're gonna make it happen. I just want to say this, you know, and I know people, I get a lot of, you know, notes, and I don't like to call it fan mail, but love mail. I get a lot of it from you guys, and you're like, everybody feels so comfortable around you. So I wanted to say, you know, correct a little bit, what everybody's major to me. Everybody's major. If you breathe, then you major to me. you know, and so you watching means just as much as the conversation I have. And I have highlighted people who don't have a claim to fame, but I like their story. And I've done that my whole life. I mess with who I like, you know, and so you ain't got, everybody ain't got to know your name. I like you. I want to hear what you got to say. I want to sit down and talk to you, you know, for the last 26 years. You know, I've been blessed with amazing clients, but I also have time to talk to the secretary at the building too and sit down and find out what's popping with her day. And so never lose the common touch. I don't care where God carries you. I'm not talking just you, Jake. I'm talking to everybody watching, everybody y'all about to tag in this video when we post it tonight. Never lose the common touch. I don't care where you go in the world. I don't care how God blesses you. Never lose the common touch to be able to talk to everybody and treat everybody the same. Everybody is greatness in their own right. You know, we all have a role and an impact that we're making. It might be in the community, might be in our own family, but we're all making an impact. That's the only reason we were born, to make an impact. So it might be for millions, it might be for your kids, but we're all major. So thank you so much. I love you guys. Tune in tomorrow night for another episode, and Monday and Thursday and Friday and next Saturday for more episodes. I'm Char. Just one thing. Have a blessed night.
See y'all later.